Hello and welcome everybody back for a webinar on anatomy of skull. My dear students, we have started anatomy of skull since yesterday, and yesterday we have completed the introductory part of study of skull, anatomy of skull. We have studied what is the meaning of skull, you know, the different bones which take part in formation of the skull. And we have also studied the bones of the cranium, that is cranial bones, altogether six of them, but totally eight because two of them are in pairs. So yesterday we have studied frontal bone, parietal bone, occipital bone, temporal bone, and sphenoid bone, and ethmoid bone. So let us proceed with today's topic, and that is episode 2 on skull. I welcome you again. And here we have decided to start with the anatomy of bones of face. So yesterday we completed bones of cranium. Today we will study bones of face. Okay. Well, let us get rid of this first. Okay, now we have to go for an eraser. Correct. Thank you. And here we go for the further study of skull, and that is study of bones of face. Okay. Yesterday I told you that there are 14 bones in the face component of the skull. So we have decided yesterday to divide, you know, skull into two components or two parts, cranium and face. So yesterday we have studied the bones of cranium, and today we will study the bones of face. Okay. And there are 14 of them. But if you consider paired and unpaired, we get eight number of bones and eight different bones. Okay. That means six are paired, 6 to the 12. And two are unpaired. So 12 plus 2, 14. So bones of the face is your today's first topic. And this is the list of bones of the face. The facial skeletal consists of 14 bones. Okay. And those are inferior nasal conchae, means because two of them are there, so we call conchae. Lacrimal bones. Okay, then maxilla bones, nasal bones, palatine bones, and zygomatic bones, they are in pair. Okay, two each. And there is mandible bone and omur bone, which are single. So they are unpaired. Okay, so 6 to the 12, 13 and 14. So altogether 14 bones are there in the face. Now we will try to study one by one, all of them. I'll take you to mandible first. And mandible is a very common bone for exams. Mostly everybody will be asked on mandible, hold this mandible, anatomical position, this and that. So mandible is actually separable from the rest of the skull. I told you, in all there are 22 bones in the skull, excluding aerocycles and excluding hyoid bone. So if you consider 22, so this bone, mandible, is separable from rest of the 21. Okay, because it forms a synovial joint with the temporal bones, a temporomandibular joint. Now let us see the parts of the mandible. Mandible has got a body. Okay, it has got an angle here, and it has got two rami. So it has got a ramus here, and it has got two processes here on this side. What you call condylar process and conoid process, mandibular notch, alveolar process with provision for, you know, holding teeth. Here you can see the body, here you can see the mandible, here you can see the mental foramina, if symphysis menta is on this side. So these all parts you should know. Remaining parts you can see through this image, and I've shown it properly. You try to understand, this portion is called as an angle of mandible. Whereas this portion is called as ramus of mandible. Whereas this portion is called as mandibular notch. Okay. Whereas this one is your condylar process, which takes part in formation of temporomandibular joint. Here you can see formation of temporomandibular joint. So mandibular fossa is formed by the temporal bone, which is the bone of cranium. Here you can see the coronoid process. Okay, and here you can see the mandibular foramina. This is mandibular foramina. This is mental foramina. Mandibular foramina is for the inferior alveolar neurovascular bundle, which supplies the lower jaw. And these are all alveolar margin with teeth. Okay, here there is a mental foramina. Here you can see the location of mandible in the total skull along with other 22, along with all the 22 bones. And you can see mental foramina here, and you can see mandibular symphysis. Actually, mandible is also formed in two different parts on either side, but they get fused, unlike maxillary bone. Maxilla doesn't get fused. It is still separate. So we count maxilla as two bones. Upper jaw, we count two bones. Whereas lower jaw, we count only one bone. So remember this. Now, next bone in the facial bones category is your maxillary bones. So maxillary bones, because there are two of them. Right? They are paired bone. Okay, paired bone. Here you can see half of the maxilla and half of the maxilla here. It is majorly, medially sometimes fused, but it is not so closely fused. It is easily separable. It appears that it is fused. You can see here, but still it is separable. So we count it as a pair. Here you can see one piece of maxilla bone. So maxilla are two. Okay, and this takes part in formation of in orbital fissure, because orbital fissure is here, and you can see the color. The color will limit its margins. Okay. It has got an infraorbital foramen here. Then it has also got alveolar process, just like, you know, alveolar process of mandible, because it has to hold teeth of upper jaw, 16 teeth, 8 on each side. Here you can see the maxilla, which is shown in the same color. Okay.
Clear, Avajit, thank you, sir.
And this one is your separate maxilla with the teeth. Okay. Here you can see maxilla right lateral wave. Okay, maxilla of the right side. Here you can see the orbital surface, because it takes part in formation of orbit also. Here you can see the zygomatic process, which gets articulated with the zygomatic bone on lateral side. Here you can see inferior orbital foramina and alveolar margin with the teeth. Here this articulates with frontal bone. So it is called as a frontal process. Well, here you can see the inferior view of the skull with mandible removed in order to show you the maxilla from below. This portion is a maxilla. You can identify with the color. And so it forms hard palate. And the part which forms hard palate is called as palatine process of maxilla. Palatine process of maxilla forms hard palate, because there is little part of hard palate which is also formed by the palatine bone, which is called as horizontal plate. This is all hard palate. Okay, and these are other parts of other bones. We are not going to do that
clear one.
We have already studied that yesterday, so we don't want to waste time on that. Now, zygomatic bones, they are in pair, so we call zygomatic bone, and they are also called as cheek bones. Just like clavicle is called as collar bone, mandible is called as chin bone, hyoid bone is called as a throat bone. Similarly, these are called as cheek bones. Cheek bones have got temporal process, one temporal process here, because it takes a part in formation of temporozygomatic. Zygomatico-temporal fissure is shown here, and it totally forms zygomatic arch. Together they form zygomatic arch, portion of temporal bone, portion of zygomatic bone, they form a zygomatic arch. Okay, so this is more important for your zygomatic bone. You can see zygomatic bone here also. The major part of the cheek is formed by that on the side of maxilla. Well, now we'll see two more bones, nasal bones and lacrimals. We are studying these two bones together because they are just plates and they are in pair. You can see these two plates of nasal bones, and you can see these two plates of lacrimal bones. Nasal means because they are on the nose, so they are called as nasal bones. And lacrimal means they are related to the nasolacrimal duct, so they are called as lacrimal bones. Lacrimal is a lacrimal system, nasolacrimal system is for the tears. And you can see the nasolacrimal groove in the nasolacrimal fossa here. Okay, it is shifted on this side. This one, this is shifted actually. This is your nasolacrimal groove. Well, now you can see two more bones here: palatine bones and omer bone. Palatine bone is a pair, and omer is single, unpaired. Don't forget that. First, you see the palatine bones. On the posterior lateral walls of the nasal cavity, they are small part of the orbits, so they form orbit also, and posterior one third of the hard palate. So I showed you during the hard palate study earlier, along with the maxillary palatine plates. So these are the horizontal plates of palatine bone. So palatine bone is a separate, it is in pair, and omer, if you see, it is in the center. Okay, just like how the sphenoid is in the center and above side, similarly omer is in the center and the lower side. And it is, as compared to sphenoid, it is small. You can see omer bone here, and it is single, and it is plow shaped. Lower part of the nasal septum is also formed by lower and backward part of nasal septum is also formed by omer. So we have almost completed 13 bones, and now the 14th bone is your inferior nasal conchae. I told you during the study of ethmoid bone that inferior nasal concha is a separate bone. And whereas superior nasal concha and middle nasal concha, they are the parts of ethmoid bone. See the color difference. Superior nasal concha and middle nasal concha, they are shown in dark yellow color. They are the parts of ethmoid bone. And inferior nasal concha is a part, it is a separate bone as such. And we count as a 14th bone of the face. Now, there are two sides for the nose, so it is in pair. Inferior nasal concha is a paired bone. One of the three nasal conchae, so it is said one of the three means one, two, three, out of that this is one. It forms the part of the lateral wall of the nose. So here the picture in front of you is the lateral wall of the nose with all three conchae and all three meatuses, superior, middle and inferior nasal meatus. Meatus means opening. In front you can see the nasal bone here. This is meant for the warmth, warming the air. These nasal conchae are also called as turbinates. You can also call inferior nasal concha as inferior turbinate, or these are superior turbinate, middle turbinate, other name for that. Okay, and remaining bones you can see in this picture. Again, I am showing you the same picture with magnification in order to show you the surrounding bones around the inferior nasal concha. You can see other sphenoid part. Different colors have been used, so you can differentiate that. This bone from other bones. You can see the frontal has got a different color, ethmoid has a different color, nasal bone has got a different color, and you can see the nasal septum also, and you can see, sorry, you can see the maxillary bone also. Here you can see the pink color is your sphenoid bone, okay, and here you can see palatine bone. Well, now we have finished all the bones of the face part of the skull. If you look at this GIF, it is shown the face as collapsible. Head is getting collapsed. If we didn't have these 14 plus 8 bones, our head would have been collapsed like this. So it doesn't get collapsed because we have got those 14 plus 8, 22 bones. So this is just to make you understand that our head is not flexible or compressible because of having lots of bones in the head and face. So we have completed all 22 bones. But I told you, if you include air vesicles, 22 plus 3 pairs of air vesicles, you get 6 bones. So you get 28 bones in the skull. And these air vesicles are malleus, incus and stapes. The stapes is the smallest bones amongst these three. And plus it is the smallest bone in your whole body. Okay. Here you can see the stapes. Where a stapes takes base of the stapes gets articulated or gets, you know, attached to the internal ear cochlea. Whereas the handle of the malleus here, you can see handle of the malleus, it gets attached to the eardrum, to the external ear. And from external ear to the internal ear, there is a middle ear in which these ear vesicles are present, and therefore the conduction of sound waves from environment to external ear to middle ear to internal ear. So you can see these bones are forming joints, two joints you can see incudomalleolar joint. So incus, while saying attached with other articulated other bone, it is not called as incudo. So incudo is used, incudomalleolar joint. So incomalleolar is not correct, incudomalleolar joint. And lower you can see incudoscapedial joint. So incudo is a word is used. And these three bones, when you separate, you can see lots of parts. For example, incus articulation portion is shown here. Here you can see the malleolar articulation portion is shown here. Here you can see head of the stapes. Here you can see the base of the stapes. And these are different portions. This is in-depth study of all these ear ossicles which are present in your middle ear. So 22 plus this 6, 28. And one bone is still remaining, and that bone is hyoid bone. Why? I told you in the beginning that hyoid bone is just immediately below the mandible, and it is not part of thorax, so it remains one, and that is why it has to be counted somewhere. So we count it in the skull itself, okay? And but it is not part of the face, so we count it as a separate. And if you consider this bone as a part of skull, you get 29 number of bones in the skull altogether. 22 plus 6 plus 1, okay? So in all, there are 29 bones in the skull, including mandible, including ear ossicles, and including hyoid bone. Hyoid bone is a small bone, and it is a comparatively a weak bone as compared to other bone, because it has got less compactness. And if you see, there are two small horns on each side, so they are called as lesser horns, and two big horns, they are called as a bigger horn or greater horn. Greater horn, lesser horn, and the body of hyoid bone. Actually, it is placed here for providing, you know, extra space for the attachment of muscles going from thoracic upper region to the mandible. For that, there is like a, it works like a relay station for the attachment of muscles and ligaments. That is the real, you know, provision of this bone. Now we have completed all 29 bones of your skull, but there are some miscellaneous aspect which is related to your head. So we'll go for paranasal ear sinuses here. I told you in the beginning also, there are four pairs of paranasal ear sinuses around the nose. Para means around, nasal means nose. These are the paranasal ear sinuses. A frontal sinuses are present in frontal bone. You can see the ethmoidal sinuses are present in the ethmoidal bone, but ethmoidal sinuses are in three pairs, anterior, middle, and posterior. Then you'll get a sphenoidal sinus. Sphenoidal sinus is present in the sphenoid bone. Then you get a maxillary sinus. Maxillary sinus is present in the maxillary bones. You can see from the lateral side or medial aspect of these four sinuses. They are meant for making your skull light and for the purpose of adding resonance to your voice, and also for the purpose of, you know, having ear condition of ear which you inspire. And these bones are also called as pneumatic bones because they contain air in it. And the last part is the foramina. Foramina means the holes which are present in the skull on the lower aspect for transmission of different arteries, veins, you know, nerves, mostly nerves. So inferior surface of inferior view of cranium is showed from inside. If you see optic canal here, it is for optic nerve. And these are all called optic canal, foramina rotundum, foramina oval, foramina spinosum, foramina lacerum. Internal auditory meatus is opening, and jugular foramen. So this is, these other words in English are for, you know, to make you understand. Optic means on, rotundum is round, oval means oval, spinosum like a spine, lacerum means lacerated, and in auditory meatus means in a mean, and jugular means like a jug. You can see all these foramina, and foramen magnum is in the center here, in the center of your skull from interior. I have shown you all these foramina in earlier study also. You have to use the skull base, and you have to take a probe, and you have to put it from above and bring it from downwards to see how it enters, how it exits. So you can see exit here on the lower surface of the interior of the skull is called external surface of inferior view. You can see here. Oval is seen here. Okay, oval. Spinosum, lacerum, carotid canal like a carrot. So it's called as carotid canal. Jugular like a jerk. Hypoglossal horizontally placed here. And stylomastoid, stylus. Stylomastoid foramen is present between styloid process and mastoid process. You can see styloid process here. styloid process here. You can see mastoid process here. So this is the stylomastoid foramina. When you go to the anatomy lab, you take a skull in your hand and you see all those holes and try to name them. And you have to explain what passes through this. For example, foramen ovale looks oval and it allows passage of mandibular component of trigeminal nerve. Carotid canal is for the passage of internal carotid artery from neck to interior of the skull. Jugular foramina is for passage of internal jugular, where the internal jugular vein starts. Likewise, every foramen has got a meaning and it has got a significance, and that is why all these foramina are to be studied by you with the help of a skull in your hand. Through pictures, I can show you this much. After I have time, I'm trying to show you maximum thing with the help of all these images. Now the next part is orbits. Orbits means you have got two eyes, and these two eyes are located in some hollow space, and this hollow space of eyes is called as orbit, right eye and left eye. So for example, we have taken here in front one orbit, and this orbit has got a roof. So you can see this roof of orbit. Then it has got a floor of orbit, you can see. And then it has got a medial wall towards the nose and the lateral wall towards the ear. And this, what different bones take part in formation of orbit, that has been shown here. For example, you can see different bones in different colors. If you go to the roof of orbit, lesser wing of sphenoid bone and orbital plate of frontal bone. So this is orbital plate of frontal bone, and this is the lesser wing of sphenoid bone here. Lesser wing, you can see orbital plate of frontal bone and lesser wing of sphenoid bone. Okay. Similarly, floor is formed by orbital process of palatine bone. Okay. Here you can see an orbital surface of maxillary bone. You can see here, and zygomatic bone. And then plus medial wall and lateral wall. If at all orbit is asked, you have to remember how these walls are formed, and different bones we have studied. With the help of those bones, you can show the formation of orbits. Okay. Now we'll go to the last part of today's episode, and that is developmental aspects of fetal skull. How this skull gets developed. Skull bones are unfused at birth. Usually during birth, all the skulls are unfused, and that is why they form frontanes, not frontanes. Frontanes. You can see the correct spelling here. Frontanes. And these frontanes are made up of membranous bones. That means they are not yet ossified. And it is for purposes to provide ossification for the purpose of growth and slight movements. There are six frontanels. One anterior frontanel, you can see here, biggest one is anterior frontanel. One posterior frontanel, you can see the second biggest, you can call. And other is mastoid frontanel here. And the last one is sphenoid frontanel. So mastoid frontanel and sphenoid frontanel, they are in pairs. One on each side, because right and left we have two divisions, on right side and on left side. So there are altogether six frontanels, and these frontanels in Marathi they are called as taalu. For example, this frontanel is very important in case of babies, taalu, because the portion is still membranous. There is no bone form, it ossifies very late. That is why you get a membrane. It's very soft here. They ossify by intramembranous ossification. That is a proof for you all to say that these bones form from the membrane. All the flat bones on the skull, they form from the membrane. And as you come downwards towards the face, the facial bones are formed 50% by membrane and 50% by cartilage, up to the level of clavicle. Even clavicle is 50%, what you call one third and two third by membranous bone, and by membrane and by cartilage. So from above up, from the top to the level of clavicle, if you see, upward bones are by membranous bone. You come by the meantime, you come to the mandible, it comes 50-50 for membranous and cartilage bone. By the time you come to the clavicle, it is one third and two third by membranous bone and cartilage bone. And remaining all bones below in your limbs and body, they are all cartilaginous bones. So this is the difference between bones of the head, that is bones of the skull, and bones of the body as far as the development is concerned. You can see the frontal bone and you can see the anterior fontanelle, you can see the parietal bones, you can see the ossificant centers shown in for the purpose of ossification. You can see the occipital bone and you can see the posterior fontanelle here. So here you can see frontal bone, you can see parietal bone with ossification center, posterior fontanelle, I can see anterior fontanelle. Now this fontanelle is called spinoidal fontanelle because spinoid bone is near to it, and later on the spinoidal fontanelle will form pterion point, pterion, because here you can see the fusion of, sorry, union of four bones, 1, 2, 3, 4 bones, and it is H in shape, and this, here the bone is weakest in the skull, and here this is actually a lambda landmark, and it is a mastoid fontanelle, it is a triangular, here it is a square, it is a triangular. The remaining parts of the bones are shown here, and I think with this we have completed the bones of all the bones of the skull as far as, you know, cranial bones are concerned, or the bones of the face are concerned. You can see through this image GIF, bones are getting disintegrated and integrated and disintegrated and integrated. You get a skull in the anatomy lab which is integrated, and when you study the osteology of the skull, you have to study the disintegrated matter. You have to study a single bone, and within a span of say half an hour yesterday and today half an hour, I have tried to complete all the bones of the skull yesterday and today. And my dear students, it is the right time to take a break, and let us take a break now and come back tomorrow morning with the remaining part of study of skull, which will be mostly based on what you call revision, and plus I'll take some quiz for you tomorrow, and come prepared means that we can have interaction regarding the study of cell tomorrow. We will come tomorrow at 10 o'clock back again for interactive session on skull, and I think we should stop here with this. I end my today's webinar on anatomy of skull. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Have a nice day ahead.